policy and economy in energy, business models in the energy sector. In this video, we'll talk about the impact the smart grid has on the business models of companies in the energy sector. At the end of this video, you'll be able to understand and explain not only what the business case is like in the energy sector, but also the new business case in the digital sector. Traditionally, the dominant business model in the industry has the sole purpose to generate electricity at central power plants and then distribute it to end consumers through transmission and distribution networks. In this relatively centralized production and distribution system, energy is treated as a product. So let's have a look at the business models of these traditional actors. The value creation of a centralized power plant is to transform primary energy into secondary energy. This way, the selling price has to cover not only the primary energy purchase price, but also operational costs, as well as cover the financial investments and generate benefits. The retailer's role consists of purchasing energy from producers in the energy market and then sell it to end users. In this case, the selling price includes, among others, electricity purchases, transportation and distribution fees, national taxes, and the retailer's operating costs, such as metering or billing fees. Suppliers differentiate their offers according to the price or origin of electricity. When it comes to regulated actors like transmission and distribution operators, business models are slightly different. This way, transmission and distribution operators convey electricity from producer to consumer, and retailers pay the transmission and distribution operators in proportion to the quantity of energy distributed. Prices are annually or quarterly defined by national regulatory authorities, which means that their benefits depend on their ability to control the operation cost and investment. As a technical system, the smart grid is a bidirectional communication and energy grid. It introduces both decentralization and digitalization of the energy sector, and it prevents companies from shifting product-based business models to service orientation. The business model keeps evolving. In regards to digitalization, from a purely technical perspective, the roles companies tend to have within the digital ecosystem are becoming present in the energy ecosystem sphere. The digital ecosystem, and more specifically the Internet of Things ecosystem, can be described through five interconnected roles. There are the device provider companies that produce, sell, or rent devices that collected raw data. This data is either ingested by the application or passed through the network. Schneider and Siemens are a few examples of this. Another role is of the network provider companies that integrate resources from other providers through communication and network infrastructures, such as network connectivity and web servers, and expose these resources to other providers. Their role is more focused on hardware. Depending on the communication technology used on the connected device, some companies that perform this role are telecommunication operators, such as Orange, Vodafone, or Sigfox, and cloud service and hosting providers, such as Google Cloud Platform, AWS, and OVH. Next, there's the platform providers, which are companies who offer API or open interface that eases the development of applications. In this case, the role of these types of companies is more focused on software aspects. Some examples include IBM Watson and IFTT. Let's not forget application providers, which are companies that conceive applications to support their activities or provide services to clients. Finally, it utilizes the capabilities of the platform, network, and device providers in order to provide for an application for the last role, which are the customers. Examples can be found in all web applications or mobile apps provided by energy retailers. A company can endorse one or several roles, leading to a specific business model, which is notably the case of AWS and Google Cloud Platform, that not only sells infrastructure location, but also a platform to ease the management of the infrastructure and data processing. These different roles can be seen as everything as a service, which changed the way software is produced, consumed, and distributed. SaaS, or Software as a Service, enables software applications to be accessed on the web directly by end users through a web browser or mobile app. IaaS Layer, or Infrastructure as a Service, offers computing resources such as processing, storage, networks, and other fundamental computing resources on demand. The platform as a service connects IaaS and SaaS to easily let developers create new applications without managing the infrastructure. The promises of everything as a service include limited investment in hardware, since owning a server isn't required. Reduced delay between the request and the provisioning. Reduced issues related to usage or demand increase. Consumers pay for its usage on a pay-per-use basis. These service-oriented business models use one of four types of pricing models. A subscription, where the customer pays for having access to the service during a period of time. A pay-per-use event, where the customer pays each time they use the service. A pay-per-use time, where the customer pays for the duration of the usage of the service. A pay-per-use quantity, where customers pay for the quantity of resources consumed by interacting with the service. In analogy with the digital ecosystem, the transmission system operators, also known as TSOs, and the distribution system operators, or DSOs, can be seen as IaaS companies, as they are paid according to the real usage of the infrastructure. The interconnectivity and data production induced by digitalization allows the emergence of intermediate actors, known as ancillary services. These ancillary services question the central position by adopting a platform as a service, or PaaS, or a software as a service, SaaS, strategy, which provides interconnection, information aggregation, and ecosystem creation. The PaaS strategy can be structured in two approaches. The first is oriented towards a physical platform. This physical PaaS strategy encompasses emerging actors, such as renewable energy aggregators or energy storage network operators, who aim to facilitate the ever-increasing supply of distributed energy resources. The second PaaS approach is data-oriented. These actors aim to ease the collaboration between customers and third parties, notable for services like grid flexibility or consumption reporting. The SaaS strategy in the energy ecosystem can be considered as software-enabled e-commerce applications. The perfect example being the virtual power plant, since it's a cloud-based software control center that aggregates the capacity of heterogeneous energy resources in order to coordinate them according to load and optimization. The business logic of PaaS aggregators, such as energy storage network operators or renewable energy aggregators, is to provide electricity storage and production means as services. It implies facilitating the integration of these distributed resources into an ecosystem. The benefits include allowing the valorization of prosumers and small renewable power plant investments, by reaching critical mass and being rewarded for their contribution to the grid through power capacity or flexibility. These actors can install, operate, and maintain distributed generation and storage. Business models evolved from microgeneration and energy storage product vendors to platform operators. One of the business models of these aggregators is to get financial inputs for the available capacity and flexibility they possess, as well as potential servicing fees for photovoltaic and battery operation or maintenance. After, their expenses come down to the cost of the energy supply, by either storage or photovoltaic ownership, and potential investment in smart metering and control devices. Concerning the data-oriented PaaS strategy embodied by data aggregators, they collect data independently or in collaboration with retailers, and then sell their analysis and predictions to DSO or TSO, allowing them to optimize the grid, and also suggest offers adapted to consumption behaviors. data aggregator sales correspond to data processing, such as flexibility or load prediction for DSO and TSO, and consumption and behavioral analysis for retailers. The expenses are related to computational resources for data storage and processing, and other expenses can be related to data acquisition, according to how they get data from consumers. Virtual power plants, as SaaS actors, take advantage of information systems to aggregate and coordinate the capacity of heterogeneous energy resources, including different types of generation power units, energy storage systems, and flexible loads, to form an energy resource pooling with the key purpose of providing ancillary services for system operators, such as DSOs. Virtual power plants mainly exchange data and action command to aggregators. It is appreciated on the energy market and rewards operators and aggregators accordingly. Virtual power plants make profit from flexibility, power capacity, and load balancing, while they have expenses from power and flexibility supply, as well as computational resources to manage transactions and from doing load balancing. Some business models also depend on the prosumer's practices, such as auto-consumption. However, decentralized production and auto-consumption of prosumers can admit different business models. Historically, when a private entity invested in photovoltaic panels, all the power generated was injected in the grid. However, policy evolved by enabling auto-consumption, which implies the consumption of a portion of the production and then the possibility to sell the electricity overage. The coming practices benefit collective auto-consumption, where even less electricity is injected in the global network, and instead, the production is shared among several buildings. The ecosystem business model promoted by service approach leads to the creation of five types of value in the energy sector and for society in general, such as economical value by reducing unnecessary costs and investments, environmental value with the facilitation of integration of renewables, reliability value with the improvement of the network and data acquisition, energy security value with the reduction of blackouts, and consumer engagement and interaction in the energy reduction dynamic. Both digitalization of the energy sector and the increasing accessibility of renewables leads to the creation of an energy ecosystem which is service-oriented. The introduction of new actors with new business models allows for the appreciation of even the smallest initiative in terms of renewables and flexibility. The business models presented are emerging, and many others are coming. This video does not intend to be exhaustive. There is an infinite number of possible business models. If we try to draw the bigger picture of the energy ecosystem, the introduction of the new actors makes it more complicated. However, it increases the possibilities to find an actor to collaborate with and contribute to the integration of renewables, whilst reducing global greenhouse gas emissions. Thanks for watching.